greetings, and welcome to the Saved by Nostalgia podcast.
I love the Power Glove. It's so bad. No!
I feel the need for speed.
Sweep the leg. You have a problem with that?
Dead or alive, you are coming with me.
Look what you did, you little jerk.
Murdoch. I'm coming to get you.
Get busy living. And get busy dying.
You are next.
And the thing is, after all these years, I still look back with wonder.
It is our pleasure right now on The Outsiders to bring on Harrison Page, veteran actor of more than 40 years. Harrison, hope you've had a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday weekend. How's everything going in your world, buddy?
Everything's terrific. I just had a really nice Thanksgiving with some friends. As a matter of fact, there were a couple of friends from an old television show that I did called CBO Shark. And we just spent the rest of the evening just laughing and clowning and having a good time.
Well, you grew up a movie fanatic, and a movie that kind of caught your eye early on was Blackboard Jungle. Can you talk about that and if that kind of made you want to be an actor?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, at the time I was living in the South, and there was a theater on Main Street, and you know, Main Street, at that particular time, you know, African-Americans had to actually go and sit in the balcony. So I was in the balcony at one very, very hot day, and I didn't know what was on the screen that day. I just wanted to go to a movie. And Blackboard Jungle came on, to my surprise, and I saw this man, Sidney Poitier. And I was so, so impressed by him. But I said, I gotta do that. I have to do that. I know I can do that, and I'm going to. And he was very instrumental in my actually getting into the business and starting to be an actor.
Well, what steps did you take after that to become an actor? How serious were you? You said you really wanted to do that. What were the next steps for you in that process?
Well, the next steps, actually, it took a great while before I could even, get into the next steps. I was in school, and then I went into the military, and then after the military, well, I actually learned that I liked performing because I joined this musical group, what they called at that particular time doo-wop group, and loved the audience response, and it just kind of made things even more clear to me about what I wanted to do. So when I got out of the military, I came to California, and I went to school, went to college, and studied theater. I majored in theater arts. I was doing all the things that you needed to do in order to really pursue this acting career, and I was in college, and people were saying, well, you know, you have the talent to do this. It was confirmed that I had chosen the right field. And then I started to go out for auditions. I found an agent who, a friend of mine, who wanted me to do a scene with him for himself, with his agent. And it turned out that they wanted me, they didn't want him. And it was those kind of things happen because, you know, there's a reason for that. And so I joined this agency, which was actually a really well-known agency at that particular time called CMA. They eventually became ICM and CAA, and I got signed up with them for doing that scene that I did with this actor friend of mine. And, you know, the rest is, you know, whatever, the rest is history.
Well, early on you did two movies, two Russ Meyer films, Vixen and Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, which was actually written by Roger Ebert. Can you talk about your experience on those movies? And those are a little different, so I kind of want to get your take.
Yeah, Vixen was actually, it was kind of a fluke because, I was still in college, and I looked in the newspaper one day, and I saw this ad for this movie, and they described this guy. guy as being black and young and kind of this rebellious type. And I, you know, like I said, I've gotten so much, you know, encouragement from college student friends and actors that I said, well, I'm going to this audition. And I went on this audition in Beverly Hills, and this guy had this house in Beverly Hills he was using as a studio. And I met this man, and his face actually looked kind of familiar. He looked like W.C. Fields, and I said, is this, you know, I was young, I said, are you sure you're not W.C. Fields? He said, no, no, I'm not W.C. Fields. Anyway, I did this scene for him, and he said, oh, you know, that's really nice. You're really kind of, unique in that you're very smooth, and whatever he was saying, you look very natural. I said, yeah. He said, what did you study at? And I told him I studied at Los Angeles City College, and that, you know, obviously I was considered to be pretty good and all that. And he said, yeah, come back to see me again, and we'll see if we can do this. And at that particular time, I wasn't a member of a union because, I just started. And so I went home, and I, you know, came and called me back again, and I did the scene for him again. And he hired me on the spot for this thing. It was the first time I'd ever been in front of a camera in my life.
Oh, wow.
And somehow or another, whatever that was I did in that movie impressed him so much that he said, I'm going to do something else, and I'm going to call you. So be ready. And I said, I'm ready. So, you know, a year or two later, he got this contract with 20th Century Fox for a three-picture deal. And he was putting together this thing called Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. And he was so impressed with me, which always kind of, I went, well, really? I'm just this college student, and you're so impressed with my acting. I mean, yeah. I don't get it. And he said, you just are a wonderful actor. So you seem to know what you're doing, and most people don't, and all that stuff. And, of course, I didn't believe him. I didn't, you know, why should I believe him? I'm a kid. So he sent me the script of Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. He was so impressed with me that I was the first person to read the script. And wow. He said, when you read the script, let me know what you think. And he said, the studio, wants me to do a lot of editing on this and cut out some things that I really want to keep there. They want me to cut all the breast stuff, all the reference to sex, all kinds of different things they wanted him to cut out. And I called him back and I said, you know what? You want to fight for this. Go ahead and fight for this because this is good. This is good stuff. I mean, it's interesting. It reminds me of laughing. It's like, it's great. And he said, you sure? I mean, he's asking me, a student, a college yeah. student. I'm going, you know, what? So anyway, so I told him, he said, okay, I'll do that. And he did that. He bought and kept all of the stuff that he wanted to, you know, to be in the script to stay there. And man, it was like this incredible relationship that just was boggles the mind. It's like when something like that happens, you kind of look up and say, you know, somebody up there likes me because, you know, this is not supposed to happen. But that's how Beyond the Valley of the Dolls happened. It also is how Vixen happened, and, you know, that whole relationship started. Beyond the Valley of the Dolls was a surprise hit in those days. Nobody thought this movie was going to do any business whatsoever because people were like, well, this is, you know, it is. It's just kind of step up from porn. I mean, come on. Nobody's going to go out to see this thing. I mean, you guys are like on the borderline of X. So you know, they were all these critics, all these people, naysayers, and everybody talking about how this movie was not going to do any business. And it did huge business. It's like people were ready for something like that or something enough. And, you know, it was a big hit for everybody. I mean, it was wonderful. It was a wonderful ride.
Well, you've done so many wonderful things. I mean, of course, I want to talk about Lionheart, one of our favorite movies, for sure. But before that, I mean, you've done so many things. We read the list before we brought you on. I mean, you did Badass just a couple years ago, CSI, Wonder Years, Columbo, Quantum Leap, 21 Jump Street, Murder, She Wrote. I left out several. I mean, Harrison, you've been involved in so many wonderful shows. And I mean, what does that mean to you to be able to look back on that and say, wow, I was a part of this wonderful show, and I mean, it's got to feel great, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. And I sometimes forget you know how you do, you kind of take things for granted, you go, oh yeah, yeah, right, yeah, right, you know. But the point is that it was, this stuff was a result of the efforts that I made to follow through on my dream. You know, people yeah. think the dreams are like, you're supposed to go, you're dreaming, and it, just like I thought, Beyond the Valley of the Dolls wouldn't do any business. I followed my dream. I said, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do the very best that I can, and I'm going to make it as an actor, because this is what I want to do. And I stayed with it. You know, I just didn't, nothing deterred me. There were several people along the way who said, you'll never make this like again. You know, naysayers said, you'll never make it. You know, Hollywood is tough, and, you know, people are strange, and, you know, you're just one little bitty human being and all this nonsense, and I just never listened to it. And, you know, doing all the work that I've done over the years is a result of a lot of hard work and study. I studied at the Actors Studio. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Actors Studio. It's a school, acting school that Marlon Brando went to, Robert De Niro, James Dean, Al Pacino, Ellen Burstyn, Meryl Streep, you name them, they all went to this school. Steve McQueen, Paul Newman, they all went to this acting school. And I somehow or another, again, found myself, you know, in the Actors Studio after having auditioned with these people, you know, Rod Steiger. They were all there. And I'm saying, I must have something, and I must be in the right place. And, for what I want to happen. And lo and behold, it did, man. So, you know, all these years of just culmination of hard work. And I've enjoyed just about everything that I've done. I'm sure also that a lot of it had to do with my attitude. My attitude was always positive, still is. It always is, you know, things are going to work out, always optimistic. I'm sure that worked great.
Well, I want to ask you, you know, what your approach was, especially for some of these shows that, you know, that you were on for an episode or two, you know, shows like The Wonder Years, where, you know, what is the approach like for something like that? Is it, okay, you get a call from the agent, hey, you got a spot for this. Do you familiarize yourself with that particular show before you do the episode? And is that kind of how it works?
Well, you know, it depends. Sometimes you familiarize yourself with the show, and sometimes you don't. It depends upon what the part is and what the script is and what the character is and the whole thing. Sometimes familiarizing yourself with the show won't help you. But if it does, then you naturally you use whatever you can to make the part work. Now, when I did the Wonder Years, they hired me to play, I believe it was a baseball coach. So far back, sometimes I can't even remember. But a baseball coach, and I, you know, doing research on playing baseball was not something that I wanted to do, because I played baseball in high school. I knew baseball. So I said, well, yeah, I'm just going to draw on that. I knew what a coach does. I played baseball, and I was a drill instructor in the military, so I knew all the things that it took to play this part. When I went out to audition for that part, those guys, I think it took maybe 3 minutes in the room, and they were already decided. I mean, they were already going, yeah, that's the guy. He got everything that this character needs, you know, the coach and the player and the whole thing. So it was almost like, you know, a given getting that part. And I had a good time doing that show also.
Can you talk about working with the legendary Don Rickles and CPO Sharkey? A great show, and just getting to work with a legend like that in the business.
Yeah, I mean, it was fun. I hadn't ever done a situation comedy. I was a little bit reticent about doing one, because I knew that it was about jokes, and I couldn't tell a joke if you paid me. So I said, well, okay, this is another venture. This is another avenue. I'm gonna go and do this. So I went to audition for a man by the name of Aaron Rubin, who actually was the producer of Sanford and Son. And, you know, I went in the office, and that particular day, Don was in the office reading with the actors. I don't know why he was reading with the group I was with. I don't know. I don't know how that happened. But I walked in, and there he was, and I had to read with him. And, you know, fortunately, thankfully for everybody involved, the chemistry between he and I was so good they couldn't deny it. Because Don Rickles, as you well know, I'm not sure you know anything about Don Rickles. He is a, you know, what will be called acid comic, irreverent. You know, the kind of guy that you know that just does a lot of put down stuff. And he was, as a matter of fact, Don Rickles was one of my favorite comedians at that time. I was on the floor laughing most of the time whenever he was on the Tonight Show. So it was like a good match. So what I did in that room was just behave and be with Don Rickles the way I knew Don Rickles to be on television, is that I just made it clear for myself and for everybody in the room that I'm going to support what comedy he does, because that's what he's about. So I had to play the straight man to him. I had to give him the lines that made him, you know, that gave him the ability to do the joke. It's called a straight person, a straight man, you know, sets up the joke. And I did it with, you know, a great deal of humor and humanity, and they loved it. And he right away took to me, and I took to him, and that's how CPO Shucky happened.
Did that in any way help you in taking the role of Captain Trunk in Sledgehammer 1986? A lot of people didn't get the script when it first came out. When you read it, did you kind of get it and enjoy doing that part?
Yeah, I did. You know, I think that I had done a couple things after CPO Sharky, but I was now introduced already now to comedy, into situation comedy. And, you know, I said, well, okay, I've got this training from Don Rickles and the kind of work that he did. It was a reverse to me, almost, of my character on CPO Sharky. It was a reverse. The character in Sledgehammer was more the Don Rickles type, because he was always attacking. He was loud, not necessarily as funny as Don Rickles, but he was that kind of growling, kind of forceful, kind of a drill instructor type of guy. So the help I got, which you just mentioned, was basically I was more the growling, attacking type person like Don was on CPO Sharky when I did Sledgehammer. And David Rashi, by the way, that whole thing happened because I went into the audition, and actors have to audition all the time. There's no such thing as not auditioning. I auditioned playing that character as full and as loud as I could, because the character was called, he was that kind of a guy who blew his top all the time. I mean, damn near having a stroke. So those people in that room were just taken aback by what I was delivering, and that part happened to me.
Of course, Harrison, we have to talk about Lionheart, 1990. What a quintessential Van Damme action flick. Of course, Jean-Claude comes to America in the early 80s, doesn't even know how to speak English. And by the late 80s, he's done, you know, Bloodsport, Kickboxer, you know, so many movies, Death Warrant, and then out comes Lionheart, which was a great movie. You were a part of that. You co-starred alongside with Jean-Claude in this movie. Just what are some of your memories working with Jean-Claude, and, you know, what kind of experience was that working on a martial arts movie like that, which is somewhat different than some of the things you've done?
Yeah. Fortunately, I didn't have to do martial arts. My character I don't think it's ever mentioned in the script or the movie that I was an ex-prize fighter. I don't think that was ever mentioned. But there is a scene in that movie that I do where I'm fighting, where you can actually see I must have been, some kind of prize fighter, because the fight scene with me and this other fellow, he's doing jabs. You know, people in movies, you don't see jabs. You know, so I said, well, if I'm an ex-prize fighter, which I don't know who came up with that, whether it was the director or it was something that I wanted to be, but I was doing, you know, jabs with you know, like jabs, like a prize fighter. And, that's what I played. My relationship with Jean-Claude was basically the same kind of chemistry that I had with everybody else that I worked with, is that I always wanted to find out what that person I'm working with was like. What am I playing to? What's there? Who is this man that I'm talking to and playing with? I have to find that, and play to it. So again, you know, I had this audition for that, and I went in there and I read with I don't know who it was. I think it was the director who liked me so much playing that character that he called in Jean-Claude to come in and read with me. And Jean-Claude and I did this whole thing. We did improvisation and all kinds of different things, and he just completely fell in love with me. As a matter of fact, later, he said to me, later, he said, you know, I like your work, and I like, I've seen your television, and I always like the work. He said, but this was a different thing for you than your television work. And he said, what I loved the most was the scene where you're trying to convince me to go out and do this fight, and you're telling me this stuff about how the fight, you know, that I should not go in and do this fight because I'm not in condition to do it. I love that what you did emotionally in that, and it just blew me away when I saw it on the tape. He said, I was actually pretty much convinced that you were it before I even came into the office, that you were terrific in this thing. And he said, I appreciate you because, you know, I know that after this movie, things are going to be really good for me. So I said, hey, man, I just did my work. I appreciate it, and I love working with you. And really what did happen was Lionheart basically kicked off his career. After that, he did one movie after the next. I mean, he was, like, doing all kinds of stuff at that particular time after Lionheart. I personally believe the best thing that he's ever done was Lionheart because he had the... You got two guys on the screen. And if you don't, as an actor, I don't know if everybody understands this, but as an actor, you got to decide what's the relationship. Is it these two guys who don't like each other, but they have to do this because they both have this mission? This guy, my character, he needs, always needs money, and always looking for some way to make a dime. And his character, which he's always looking to somehow or another get his self-esteem and pride back. So, therefore, he's got his thing and I got mine. But that wasn't really what, you know, the story was. As far as I was concerned, the story was these two guys fall in love. Not in a erotic sense, but in a platonic sense. These guys, you know, no matter what happens between the two of them, you can see these two guys really love each other. And that's what that movie is about. Is that here's this guy from France who was an escapee from the Foreign Legion. And here's this guy he meets on the street who looks at him and first of all sees this guy who doesn't speak English well. And he's trying to get by and he's on his own. And he's just as disenfranchised as my character is. So they hook up, and then you got this thing between these two guys. And there's a part in the middle there where that is threatened because, you know, my character says, I'm not going to bet on you because you're going to lose with you in your condition. So, you know, I'm out. I'm going to get my money, and I'm out of here. Well, what do you see in the film? I don't know whether you remember it or not, but you see this kind of retribution that happens after the fight, where the both of them have to come to terms with their feelings for one another. I don't know if you remember this or not.
Oh yeah.
But after that fight,
Oh yeah, we definitely do.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Well then, you know, again, I know I'm talking a lot here, but I really love doing the film, and it's, as far as I'm concerned, that's kind of like the best work I've ever done.
Oh, yeah. I mean, can you talk about your role as Joshua in the film, a guy working penny dollar fights in the streets? And you really just took on that role and were just quintessential person for that role, I think. Some people even think Oscar nominations were in order for you.
Well, that's true. As a matter of fact, you know, that you mentioned that, I don't know where you got that information, but you're right on, spot on about it. Because my agent at that particular time, who saw it, called me and said, you know what, if this was a different kind of film, you'd be nominated. He said, but the genre, because it was a martial arts movie, it was that genre, and that genre, you know, nobody gets nominated in that genre because it's just basically action. And he said, if it had been another kind of film and you were playing that character, you would have not just been nominated for the Academy Award, you would have won one.
Yeah, exactly.
And of course, I don't even think about stuff like that, but I thought, whoa, wow, that's good, huh? But Joshua, for me, was such a revelatory kind of a character for me, because here's the inside of that character. The inside of that story is that my dad, who was a musician, lived in New York, and I hadn't seen him in, well, I mean, years. I mean, he left before I was out of the womb. I mean, and I never met him. But a few years before that, I finally met my father.
Wow.
Who played piano for Duke Ellington and you know, Count Basie and these people that he used to do background work on. Now, I didn't know that he was doing this stuff, and I did not know how successful his career was in the 50s, because he had this bebop stuff that was so, you know, so listened to, so, you know, so so famous in those days. And I hadn't got a clue. So he and I, for the first time in our relationship, actually got an opportunity to sit down and talk to one another. And I had not heard my dad talk. I'd never, you know, I just knew that he was a musician when I was living in Georgia, and he played his records on radio. And I didn't even know it was him. Somebody else told me it was him. So we sat down and talked. And he started to talk. And the voice of my father and the way he talked is Joshua.
Wow.
My dad had this kind of, he stuttered a little bit, he was jazzy, and, you know, he came, man, I'm look at it, you gotta understand something, I had to go to, you know, New York, I had to get away from the South, because, I mean, I hated this Jim Crow thing, I had to get out of there.
Yeah.
That was my dad.
Yeah.
So, the secret of Joshua is that Joshua, you know, God rest his soul, was my dad.
That's unbelievable.
That was my thought.
That's really, really cool, and that you're able to find that. And as an actor, that's what I think that when it comes down to it, you know, people like us, we have this radio show, we talk to a lot of people, but to know that there's people out there like you that have a talent like that, that can find that emotion and can express it in ways like that. I think that's the true essence of an actor, and that's maybe one of the most impressive things that actors like you do. I mean, that's unbelievable.
Yeah, I know. And everybody I tell that to says, oh, that was your dad? I said, yeah, that was my dad. You know, my dad didn't limp, but my dad was that, of that character was my father.
Well, hopefully your dad would have bet on Van Damme, though. I mean, surely he would have the wherewithal to take Van Damme in a Van Damme movie.
Well, fortunately for everybody involved, my dad saw the movie.
Wow.
It was before he died, and he saw the movie. As a matter of fact, that was one of those rare times he actually called me and told me that he saw the movie. He was so impressed by it. And he said to me, wow, man, that was way, you know, that's really good, man. He did that thing. That was wonderful.
Well, what?
I said, yeah. He said, who is that you're playing? I mean, that's a look. It seems familiar to me. I never told him. I wish I had, but I never told him.
Well,
he didn't know.
There was a family element to this movie, I think, which makes it a little deeper. I mean, and at one point in the film, you have to kind of play the role of, okay, this mother and daughter, they don't really want anything to do with Van Damme's character, and so you kind of have to play the part of this insurance guy that comes in and gives them the money. I mean, did you use some of that for that too? I mean, obviously you had to have some sort of wherewithal and memories of kind of your family situation and how, as it, you know, resulted in, for these people.
Yeah, well, no, that was that part of me. I actually enjoyed that so much because there's a part of me that loves to be able to do something for somebody and see their faces when you do it. You know, when you want to help somebody out, you want to look at their faces and see their faces, and see the change in their faces and the fact they're so grateful that you're doing something for them. So when I was doing this scene, the thing that really really pushed me was that I got an opportunity to go in there and go, you got the money, whatever that is I'm saying. It was a fun thing for me because, like, I get a chance to, like, I get a chance to be this kind of, you know, favor, this kind of, you know, rescuer of these people, because that's something that I always see myself doing. But in terms of that family, those two people, in fact, Lisa, the last name, Hug, was somebody I knew actually before the film, and I always thought she was a wonderful actor. The little kid became a big kid and was in a couple of Mel Gibson movies. Now, one of them, Women Want or something like that. Ashby was in that as a teenager. She played his teenage daughter.
Awesome.
But, you know, that film, even today, I think about that film, and other people say to me the same thing that you just said. That's a wonderful characterization, man. How did you come up with that? Now, I don't tell everybody that it was my dad. Sometimes I say, I just came up with
exactly.
I just thought about it. And, you know, they don't know. They will now if they listen to this.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We've got the inside scoop here.
Yeah, you got it, man. You got it.
What was it like working with the Keseys, good friends of Jean-Claude Van Damme, Michel and Abdel Kesey, who were in the movie Lionheart? What was your working relationship like with them?
Michel? What did Michel play?
He was one of the Foreign Legion guys after Jean-Claude.
He was one of the guys that was chasing?
Non-Russian guy.
I got it. No, I had a great relationship with those guys. They were, like, around all the time. And they were, like, you know, they were those people. I mean, everything about them were those people that they were playing on the screen. I didn't get a chance to talk to them a whole lot, but, I remember having a pretty good relationship with them.
Well, before we let you go, and you've been so generous with your time, and this has been just, I can't tell you how much it means to be able to talk to you, and for this length of time, we really appreciate it, of course, especially during a holiday weekend, but, you know, we got to talk about what you're up to today. Of course, you're still rocking and rolling. You just did Badass with Danny Trejo a couple years ago, and obviously involved in some other projects. Let everyone know out there, you know, what where they can see you and what other things you got coming up.
Well, actually, I'm finishing up a script. I just completed it, and I'm doing some polishing on it. Probably the next thing that you're going to see me doing is this script that I'm just finishing that I intend to direct and star in. And I've had some people interested in doing it and also some people interested in funding it. And so that's probably the next thing. It may be another thing between my doing that and now, but I'm not really concentrating on that. I'm concentrating on this piece, and I'm so determined that it's unbelievable to get it done. But that's probably the next thing.
One quick question I had for you before we let you go is about your role in Quantum Leap as Revan Walters. Doing that role and doing the scenes with Scott Bakula, who's playing a teenage girl in the show, what was it like doing scenes with him back and forth while he's standing there in a dress?
Well, you know, you have to suspend disbelief. I mean, he's there as a woman, and I got to make, you know, as far as I'm concerned, he's that woman he's playing. And so, you know, I have to use my imagination and say this is not Scott Bakula dressed up in a dress. It's this girl. It's this teenage girl. You know, that's an actor's job. He has to make everything, you know, real for me, the truth and everything like that. That's what you have to do with. I think everybody who had to deal with Scott Bakula on that show had to do some kind of stuff where they had to make him what he looked like. And, totally speaking, I mean, Scott Bakula was really, somebody that was, he was a nice guy, he was encouraging, he was there, a total professional, had a great time with him, and after we did the piece, he shook my hand and said, you did a fantastic job, and the girl that played my daughter is a beautiful girl, easy to work with, incredible singer. She's still a around doing things. I had a great time, and I, you know, the end result of which was, you know, an Emmy nomination. So, yeah, it was great.
Absolutely. Was so many great things. So many great things, Harrison, you've done. We just would have to do about three different shows with you to get to them all. You're just such a classy guy, and you've been around, you've done all these things, and we cannot thank you enough for joining us today, Harrison. We really hope for continued success, and you've just been a real pleasure, and we really appreciate it.
Well, no, thank you. Thank you very much. I'm so sorry that I didn't get the first call, but we did do this, and it was a pleasure doing this with you.
Hey, we work with a lot of athletes, and we get pushed to the side quite a bit by them. This is nothing compared to working with athletes. So, hey, we appreciate it a lot.
I understand.
Absolutely. Well, you take care, and you know, best wishes to you and yours, and have a great rest of the weekend, okay?
You too. Bye-bye.
Take care, Harrison.
Madhouse out there, man. Hey, my man. Hey, huh? Hey, look at you. Yeah. You ready to get rich? Huh? Come on, throw a few.
I took all my money out of the bank and I put a bet on myself. We're going to win this fight.
Confidence. That's what I like to hear, man. You know what I'm saying? All right, what is it, man? Anyway, hey, huh? You been hiding something all week long. What's going down, man?
Huh? Nothing.
Nothing, huh? Nothing?
Easy.
But you know what's circulating out there, man? Huh? $12 million motherfucking dollars, man. Cynthia's friends have come through like a motherfucker, man. And then I hear this shit about Attila. Man, this dude's already bagged 8 bodies.
I'll beat him.
Beat him? You ain't gonna beat him now if y'all fucked up. How you gonna beat him if y'all fucked up?
I'll beat the guy. I have to.
You don't have to do shit, motherfucker, but get yourself all fucked up like I did. Is that what you want? Be out there on the street, motherfucker, running $5 fights with winos and junkies?
I'm gonna take you away from this shitty business. You and my family. Even Cynthia, if she wants to.
Cynthia? You think Cynthia gives a flying fuck about you? Huh? You know what your problem is, man? You got a big heart, Lionheart. I mean, you're strong as a lion, man. This right here. This is what fucks you up and leaves you bleeding on the motherfucking ground with nobody to give a two-bit shit about your ass. Look, Lionheart, nobody gives a shit about you but you, man. Nobody.
You care about me. I'm gonna win that fight. You've got to trust me. Cynthia, she bet against me. I know it.
You're right. She bet against me. Damn it, this dude's gonna kill your ass. Don't you know that? This dude's gonna kill your ass, man. Don't you know that?
He's hurt. Come on, Mom. Come on.
Who's gonna kill your ass? Don't you know that? I told you the way this shit did me. Don't let it do you, man. Stay the fuck down. Come on, man. Come on, look. We don't need the money, man. I got us a deal. I told you, 50-50 all the way down the line. Well, I'm gonna split it with you, man. 50-50 all the way, man. Just like I said I would. Look,
It's on him, man. The whole bet's on Attila.
Wrong bet.
Family's going to be okay now. It's time to go home. Let's go. Let's go.
You definitely got heart, Lionheart. Don't ever lose it, because you never get back.